So, Arunima, we'll be starting now.
All right.
Hello everyone. The Indian judicial system, like most justice systems around the world, is based on precedent, which means that the judgments from the higher courts are binding on the lower courts. And in the absence of a clear statutory provision, these judgments become the law of the land. Now, daunting. Like just this one statement as a first year is so daunting to comprehend. And you know, everyone in your shoes who has been in your shoes, who is right now in your shoes, understanding and comprehending what exactly judgments are, how do you study them, you know, is a daunting process. It boggles everyone. But with the right guidance and the right roadmap on how to navigate judgments, you know, you would realize that judgments are very important sources of legal knowledge as well as a key instrument to understand. Hello everyone, thank you so much for joining us for the second session of the Manupatra webinar series on how to read a judgment and prepare case analysis. I'm Soumya Snehal. I am a 2020 graduate from CNLU, and I've been working with Manupatra as their marketing and corporate communications and research lead. With me for this session, I have Arunima Shastri. She is, you know, a professor of the Christ University in Delhi NCR, as well as she's an alumnus of NLU Orissa and UTS. Before we begin, you know, I would just like to share a little bit. In my first year, the first case that I came across was the Aruna Schomburg case, the passive euthanasia case. And I remember it being such a huge judgment. I took a printout and, you know, comprehending the entire judgment just, you know, boggled me. And when we are planning this webinar series on what first years exactly need, this was one of the first things that came to our mind that, you know, it would have been so much helpful if I had a roadmap on how do you navigate judgments, or if we have had a session on exactly just on understanding what judgments are. So again, thank you so much everyone for joining in. In this session, we are going to discuss how do you read a judgment, be it a 2-page judgment or a 200-page judgment. Arunima, with all her experience in her law school, as well as, you know, she is a professor right now and she takes a lot of sessions with students in India and abroad. So thank you so much for joining, Arunima. I couldn't think of a better person to take this session. And, you know, you can begin now.
Thank you for the generous introduction, Sneha. I just want to confirm if I'm audible to all of you.
Yes,
I think the participants can just put it in the chat box. Thank you. Could you please share the presentation with me? Yes, I'll just share. Yeah. All right. Good afternoon, everyone. And as I'm told that this is the audience is comprising mostly for the first years of law school. So I think we'll begin with the basics first, instead of just jumping and reading the cases. Very briefly, when I say analyzing and reading a judgment, why do we even read a judgment, let alone analyzing it? So as Alexander Hamilton had said once, that laws are a dead letter without courts to expound and define their true meaning and operation. So law will function in vacuum. It will operate for and in the society. It also operates, it influences the attitudes of the people who are living in the society, but law is an instrument of social change. And therefore law cannot be static. If we move on to the next slide, could you please change the slide? Yeah. So before we get into reading what and how should we look at a judgment or an order for that matter, and how should we begin to read it, we should first understand what is the need or necessity of even reading this. So as law is fluminous, which means law is not static, and law cannot be static, otherwise the progressiveness of society will be put on hold. So changes constantly. The society progresses or the law marches ahead. It could be either of the situation. And here, students, judiciary plays a major role for inculcating this change, since judges have been given the power to interpret, to redefine the laws as when there is a situation where ambiguity is there or certain light has to be given to the understanding of provisions. Through their judicial decisions only, through this one instrument, is how they are the guiding light of our legal system in India. And therefore, you'll be hearing a lot of it that this is established or a settled law, it becomes a precedent. So all of these solidification of law or the judgment emanating from different courts, these are reiterating the necessity and need of judgment or its role, its pervasive role in the society. So we as law professors, you as law students, we cannot just rely on legal rules. They are not enough and they will never be enough for researching in law. So therefore, analytical skills are required when you're reading a judgment. How will you extract the ratio, the observations of the court? How will you apply the principles the judge has applied in terms of determining if at all it has been rightly applied? The idea of reading the judgment should never be that, okay, the judge has to be right by the end. You have to critically evaluate if these principles have been rightly put forth or not. Next slide, please. Now, because we are new to law school, so therefore judgment, order, decree, judicial opinion, judicial decisions, these must be certain troubling words for you. And I hope by this session you will have little clarity as to what they are. And a more application-based clarity would be when you go on to intern in the courts and you see actual documents when you're assisting a lawyer or a judge there. So judgment is defined as any decision that is emanating from a court. It may be pertaining to question or several other questions or issues with regard to the parties that the court is trying to settle. And the way the court is trying to settle, that the shape that it takes is that of a judgment. Then many a times judicial opinion and judicial decisions are interchangeably used. They are quite interchangeably used in various other jurisdictions. But for the time being, we'll try to retain this understanding that judicial opinions are simply explanations of the judgment. So they are opinions, but they are not judgments in entirety. Whereas a judicial decision would be a judgment in entirety. So judicial decision is equivalent to a judgment. We might refer them interchangeably, but rather we will not refer judicial decision and judicial opinion interchangeably here and after. Now, coming to order and decree, there's something called Code of Civil Procedure. Might sound daunting to you at this moment. It defines judgment, order, and decree separately. In it, judgment is a statement that a judge gives out on the grounds of decree or order. Now, what is a decree or what is an order? Order is given under Section 2, subclause 14. It is a formal expression, any expression that the court gives out in basically a civil court here, it will be an order. But a decree rather would be a formal expression, definitely a formal expression, but it will determine the rights and party, the rights of the parties with regard to some or all of the matters which were in conflict, which the judge was initially trying to decide upon. Now, it may be a preliminary decree, it may be a final decree, but the part that the decree will definitely have will be an operative portion where the rights are rightly allocated to the parties and the dispute is sorted by the end. Now, judgment can have both, but an order cannot be called judgment, a decree cannot be called judgment. So let's be clear about it at this instance at least. Next slide, please. Now, elements of judgment. At the outset, not confusing you into the details of how many kinds of judgments exist or the nature of judgments that exist based on the kind of petitions that are being brought in the court, we will simply identify them into three categories: civil, criminal, and appeal-based. Civil, now what are civil matters? Civil matters may be related to debts, or property-related matters, eviction from the house, foreclosure, or to fix a bad living condition, or maybe a car accident, medical malpractice, environmental harm, subjects related to marriage, children, divorce, child custody, child support, and so on and so forth. Whereas when I talk about criminal, the most necessary part of a criminal judgment would be that the accused at the end is either punished or acquitted. And if punished, there needs to be a quantum of punishment that has to be mentioned there very specifically. So apart from a judgment that we'll have a look at different elements, at the onset, the judgment definitely has the determination of certain key issues, the decision of the court, and the decision is substantiated by on what grounds has the court arrived into that decision. Next slide, please. Now, first element and the most important element would be caption. Now, what is a caption? X versus Y, C versus R. Here we have Fahima Saleem versus State of Kerala and others. So this is your caption. That is the first thing you should notice when you are trying to let, when you have a case at hand, which are the parties here. Now, there may be certain confusion with regard to why is there appellant written, why the other party is a respondent. Sometimes plaintiff is written, sometimes petitioner is written. While on the other side, the other party, it may be a respondent, it may be a defendant. So these are quite little confusing words. Even I was confused when I was in my first, second year and was going through some novice moot court competition. So I used to carelessly use any of these words. So plaintiff would be a person who brings a lawsuit or a civil action. And defendant would be the one who is defending against the plaintiff's claim. Here, when it is written appellant, which means that there is an appeal filed from a lower court to the High Court of Kerala, and therefore this party becomes an appellant, while the party responding to that appeal is a respondent here. Now, next slide, please. Next element here is case number. Okay, you can change the slide, or I will probably continue from this slide only. So case number is a number that a plaintiff or a complainant or a petition or an appeal will have at the filing stage. So remember, at the filing stage, the number that is being given is the case number, and same is highlighted here. WP is writ petition, C stands for civil, number 19716. So this is a unique, let's say, a number allotted by the registry, where with this one number, any case having this one number would be identified. For example, Keshwanand Bharti, the writ petition is 287, which is a civil case of 135 of 1970. I'll just type it out here in the chat box so all of you can also see. Yeah. Now this number that is being given, that remains same in every journal that has probably reported this case. So therefore, your case number will be a unique number that through which case can be identified. Next is the case citation. Next slide, please. Yeah, case citation, if you can see, equivalent citations are written. Now, what are citations? Basically, there are certain reporters. I have a list of the reporters that generally report all the cases based on different subject matters. There are a number of reporters, but for the time being, we will remember All India Reporter or Supreme Court Cases, SCC. For this AIR, their style of reporting or the style of citation, as we call it, is different. And I'll just type it on the chat box so we can probably then decipher what is what and how is it being referred to. Now, there's a case citation that I have given here, Maruti Suzuki Limited versus CCE. Now, Maruti Suzuki Limited versus CCE are the parties contesting. Now, 9 is the volume number reported in Supreme Court cases, page number 193. And so whenever, let's say you go out for an internship, and then the lawyers definitely have a humongous library with all the AIR's hard copies and SEC hard copies, and they'll ask you to pull the right case out. And then you should know what the citation stands for exactly. Because if you are just you are aware of how do you cite a case would not be very relevant in terms of you being able to identify that hard copy of the case and give it to your judge that you're or a lawyer that you're assisting here in this regard. So therefore, case citation, this is also one of the ways you can search the cases. You can search the cases by the parties which are contesting or which have contested. Apart from that, case citation remains to be unique, but it is differently cited in different, the case law reporters cited differently. So now SCR and AIR, Supreme Court Reports, and AIR, All India Reporter, will cite the same case differently. I'll probably share that one document at the end. That basically gives you an equivalent citation of any case that you want to. That is something that even I came across yesterday while I was searching. So then next slide, please. The next important element is the bench. Who is hearing this case? Now there may be this part that is honorable judges or quorum tells you the number of judges who have presided in deciding this one case. Now, why is it relevant? It is relevant because sometimes the cases are overruled. But how are they overruled? It will only be overruled, let's say, if there's a single judge who has given out a judgment on a particular subject matter. Now, that can be only overruled by a division judge bench. And then the opposite is not possible, right? So anything that a division judge division bench basically gives out, it cannot be overturned by a single judgment. And therefore, the quorum or how the constitution of judges here are placed in the right order are also important. At times when you're appearing for your moot court competitions and you're citing a case, the judges may ask that who were the judges or how many judges were presiding in the case. So therefore, going into the details of the authors of this judgment is equally important in this regard. Next slide, please. Now, the procedural journey of the matter. Now, when you open a case, we'll open a case after the end of the presentation, and we'll try to look at these different elements that I've spoken to you about. So it includes certain background. How has the case traversed its journey and it has arrived in a high court or a Supreme Court of which the judgment that you're reading? It is important to know its journey. It is important to know a little background about the case, apart from that is already given in the facts about the parties and the conflicts, to have a better understanding from which court it is emanating from, and is it an appeal-based judgment or an SLP or whatever it is. The other is description of parties. Now, when the judge is writing the judgment, giving out the judgment, they start on by describing the parties who are involved in the case and who has initiated legal proceeding against the other. With that, they start on with the facts. Next slide, please. That is facts. Now, they will not cover every fact when they write the judgment. If you get to see the plain that was filed originally, or the written statement that was filed, and all the proceeding or whatever arguments were taking place, only the material and admitted facts are something which are placed in the judgment. Now, material facts would be very, very relevant, and of which the evidence that's been produced in the court has also been admitted. Otherwise, that fact will merely be a testimonial given by one of the witnesses, which definitely needs a chief and a cross if there is a criminal case there. Admitted facts generally are there, and even otherwise, if it is traveling to an appellate court, in that case, when the appellate court tries to review the decision of the trial court, then the admission of certain factual conclusions that it does out of the findings of trial court, if they are not erroneous, if they're erroneous, then it will not take it. But if they're not erroneous or absurd, then in that case, the factual conclusions that is being adhered to by the superior court also would be your admitted facts for that particular case. So when we are reading the judgment, you'll mostly find in first, if it's a long judgment, then it will go on to a number of paragraphs. But first 3 to 4 paragraphs are dedicated in terms of explaining the facts of the case, and only the facts which are relevant, which will later on help when you're reading a judgment, and also when the judge was authoring that judgment, which will lead to the determination of certain issues. Otherwise, haywire facts are of no relevance and will not be put in that judgment at all. The next element that you will find in a judgment will be contention of the parties. Now that facts have been placed rightly in the order, there will be arguments that both the parties have put forth, their counsels have put forth, right? Now, not all arguments again will form part of the judgment. There will only be certain contentions that they have. We can move on to the next slide, because there is a picture that I have posted. So here it's a clip from a judgment. I'll just move on to the judgment completely when at the end of this presentation, wherein the parties are trying to. So this, I'll just tell you the fact of the case at the onset so that you don't get confused. Basically, the operation of mobile phones were restricted in a hostel, and there was a certain time frame given within which the mobile cannot be operated. And if the student does so, they will be asked to leave that hostel premises. And what the respondent sides were contending that there was a meeting held and the parents have agreed to this, and thereof we have implemented this rule. Now, within this case, the student who is the appellant here has filed in the High Court of Kerala. You've seen the same judgments case citation that earlier we were discussing. So the student has basically contended that we have a right to internet, and therefore it is also one of the identifiable rights under fundamental rights, and this cannot be violated, and more so a gender-based violation wherein only girls hostel, they are implementing this one particular rule. So the contention is that this is a gender-based violation, citing CEDAW convention and Beijing convention, and also the UGC guideline that have been given, where more and more progressive and promotion of equity must be there in the education institution. So these are the contentions that one of the party is placing while the arguments are going on in the case or in the proceeding. Then, next slide, please. Thereof, the contentions of both the parties are recorded, and then the court moves on to deciding and ascertaining what are the issues. Now that they've heard, okay, this is the problem, this is how it is infringing my right, the other party will say, no, it is not infringing my, I'm not trying to infringe or overstep in any of your rights, this is probably the duty that I'm discharging because the state has given me the autonomy to do so, or whichever the kind of arguments that the parties have, will lead the court to extract the issues. What are the problems based on which the decision will now be given by the court? So now a legal issue will have two aspects. The point of law in dispute, is there a law where certain more explanation, interpretation has to be rendered by the court if at all? or the law that will decide whether or not this is an infringement of right or violation of right. So there's the point of law in dispute will always be there in the issues that are being put forth. Even here you can see. And then there will be key facts of the case that are relating to that point of law that is in dispute, based on which the further delivery of judgment will follow up by the judge. Next slide, please. Now, case laws. You will see, if you go back and see Nafte Johar's judgment, or any other judgment for that matter. Nafte Johar, I said, because it has innumerable, insurmountable case laws being given, but it establishes the jurisprudence very, very well. Reading a case law is like reading a book, and therefore there is no escape to it. And therefore I'm making you go through each and every element so that you have some idea, bare idea into the mind when you open today after the session, any, let's say a case or a judgment. You would know that, okay, these are the important things I have to sieve through. I have to understand and then analyze at the end. So there are case laws. Now, there are case laws which, why the judge basically put forth case laws after the issues are being given. There are many case laws based on which the contentions of the parties are being debated and argued over in the court. Then there are case laws which the judges also supplement in the understanding, where if they are trying to reason down a judgment, they have to supplement and substantiate with the already decided cases. So to solidify their judgment, their reasoning, their decision, their logic, they have to bring up such cases. And therefore, these cases are being put forth in the order of making a most or aligning their understanding of the conflict that there is within the parties. Next slide, please. Now, post making use of these cases, now the court has to, the court cannot beat around the bush. So the court has to apply either the takeaways of the cases or the law that is in question or the law that is in dispute. They have to give an application of the law. How will it now be understood, implemented, enforced, or hereinafter to cull out the problems that initially this case has brought in front of the court? So the application is being considered. Now this is, the clip is from Anuradha Bhasin's judgment, wherein, if you remember, in the state of Jammu Kashmir post 370 abrogation, there was internet shutdown, and section 144 of CRPC was imposed. And now the interpretation of how should you and on what conditions should you impose section 144 has been given within the paragraph 140 of this judgment by the court, that you cannot simply apply based on just the fact that there is an apprehension of danger or there is a danger, a pertinent danger. You have to see that it does not suppress the legitimate expression of opinion or a grievance. So here the court, if you read and if you try to understand, has tried to balance out that, okay, if there is some authority given, that authority cannot stand at the highest pedestal compromising all the constitutional values or the constitutional rights that are being given. So therefore, this is an interpretation. And this is the application of the law that they're trying to put forth, that this is how you rightly write or in the most correct manner, understand the application of section 144 of CRPC. Thereof, this is the most important part of the judgment, apart from the final verdict. So we move on to the next slide. That is your final verdict, or what has the court finally decided? How has the court finally given the rights, obligations, or had stood for certain violations or infringement that has been caused by either of the parties? How had court rightly placed all of that in the right manner, and how the directions and orders will now prevail henceforth after this judgment is something which is given in the final verdict. Now, this Anuradha Bhasin's judgment if we look at, I'll share it possibly after one or just one, there's just one more slide after this, I remember. So I'll make you go through the same clips that I have probably put in here. You'll be able to see. Now, this is a very structurized judgment wherein issues, contentions, facts, and then conclusion, everything has been structurized by the authors of the judgment themselves. So you need not see through it. Whereas the other judgment of the High Court of Kerala that I made you look at a few of the clips, there you have to see through. There you have to, use your tools and applicability of how do you identify issues. Of course, facts are very much visible in their prima facie visible because they are there at the beginning of the judgment mostly. But then how do you call out the issues? How do you call out how has court tried to determine the rights? And then how has court finally concluded is important in this regard, where the judgments are not that structurized or maybe a content page is not being attached at the onset of the judgment. So now, of course, a little more light into the verdicts that are being given. Sometimes when you see there are many, there are 7 judge bench or a 5 judge bench or a 9 judge bench or a 13 judge bench for that matter. There will be minority and majority judgment. Now, of course, majority judgment prevails. The majority opinion prevails, not judgment. The majority opinion prevails. And it is important to understand that if you're seeing, the ratio of the case is 2:1, you need not neglect the dissenting part. The possibility is, because law is voluminous and subject to change, the possibility is that maybe a dissenting opinion someday would be upheld by any of the other courts in future. Now, within the majority opinions, there is concurring opinion. Now, within the concurring opinion, what happens is there are some judges who may agree and write a separate opinion, offering a different reasoning altogether. But they will come down to the same conclusion that the other judges have. Now, that is a concurring opinion. While when the judges completely disagree and favoring the party that has perhaps lost the case here, that will be a dissenting opinion in this regard. But as a law student, your duty is to very clearly identify them and read them and give due emphasis to the entire judgment, not just focusing on the majority opinion part or the minority opinion part for this matter. There are other, within the judgment, within the important part, or let's say the takeaway of the judgment that you call, there are two sub elements which are, one is ratio decidendi and the other is obiter dicta. I'm sure you've heard a little bit about it, but of course, what you need to remember for the longest time is obiter dicta and ratio decidendi, you cannot clearly demarcate, this is obiter dicta. And definitely ratio decidendi is clearly visible in a judgment when you read. But obiter dicta may not be that clearly or something that on the face of it, you'll be able to remember and analyze. But please understand, when the court is trying to determine certain, issues or certain points in a case, if they're necessary to the end judgment that the court has given, that will be your ratio decidendi. If they're not that necessary at that point, and they're not delivering or aligning itself to the final judgment that the court has given, then that will be an obiter dicta or hypothetical assumptions that a court takes up with regard to certain subject matter would be your obiter dicta. But again, you cannot negate or completely move out from not reading the obiter dicta, or when you read, it is encapsulated within the judgment. So there is no, separate compartment given to the obiter dicta within the judgment. But then this is something that you have to understand when you're writing the ratio of the case. You should be able to call out that what is the determining point that the court has given, and based on that determining point, what has the court finally said or finally given its analysis or judgment on, and that will be a ratio decidendi. Ratio decidendi, which has been this is the authoritative element, or which later on becomes a precedent or binding on the other courts if it is given by the superior court. Other than that, when you open a judgment, there may be a possibility you will read reportable, which means there are also judgments which are not reportable. Now, there was, some 3-4 years back, Justice R.M. Chaya of the Gujarat High Court had said that even if it's a non-reportable judgment. Now, reportable judgment is one which AIR, SEC, all of these publish, which are published in the journals. Non-reportable judgment will not become reportable ipso facto if they are published online by anybody. So here a person, a third party, he had published it online, and then the other parties dragged him to the court saying that this was a non-reportable judgment. You could not possibly would have posted on the internet or even in any of the digital media. So the judge said that, okay, non-reportable means we are not sending it out or to the certain law reporters to compile them as part of the cases they compile. It's just a non-reportable judgment. It may not be very, very relevant in terms of the contribution that it has given in the law, legal jurisprudence. So that may be a possibility, but then it does not become reportable only if it is, if it gets published somewhere in the online media. Next slide, please. Now, coming to the outcome, when you have already read a judgment, there needs to be some outcome that what is it that you do after finally reading a judgment. Now, because you are all first year students, there'll be a possibility that let's say some internal assignments or where you have to give submissions for the courses, you're expected to write case analysis or a case comment. So this is one very distinctive, let's say, outlined steps given one by one by a compendium that was published by NLU Delhi. Now, you may ask me a question that, okay, how do we choose the right case or the case on which we should be writing a case comment? Your answer lies in point number 15. If that case has contributed to new jurisprudence, or it has stressed on the need to amend the law, or it has stressed on the need that there needs to be a change in the policy or practice, you have your answer. That is when you would come to know that, okay, this is one case you can definitely read at length and write a case analysis or a case comment for the same. Now, you, of course, the case analysis or case comment will follow the same scheme that the judgment follows. But it is not that you have to cut, copy, paste and write it in the manner the judgment has been given. Otherwise, it will not be a case comment. Comment means somewhere your analysis is required, somewhere your critical thinking is required, somewhere your original contribution is required. Like the judge has given an original contribution by a way of the judgment, you have to analyze, see where there are still loopholes, see where maybe there's a point which was not appreciated in the case, which you think was rather important to be appreciated. Or look for certain new phenomena that maybe the case has brought into the discourse of law. So you begin with the background. You give an outline of what the relevant issues are, what are the laws this case is surrounding itself with, and then give a critical review of the journey, maybe that maybe the case was not required for it to be filed in the High Court as an appeal or in the Supreme Court as an SLP. Maybe the case, what was decided in the trial court, it was very rightfully decided, but unnecessarily traveled through various courts. And maybe now the judgment, it has got twisted and it has been, made up in a manner which is more complex. And maybe a trial court's judgment was far more simpler. The idea of writing judgment and then, of course, writing case analysis is that you have to be lucid in the language. Do not complicate further if you think the case is already complicated for you. Then, of course, you have to write from what the prosecution or the defense has said at various levels in the trial court or the appellate level. Then you examine the precedents that has been assessed by that court. Were those right precedents that the court has adhered to, or there are possibility of other precedents which the court have rather taken care of while it was giving out a judgment? And then, like I said, ratio decidentiae on obiter dicta are relevant portions when you write a case comment. And then judgment. 13th point is very, very relevant, that you cannot just simply write, okay, this case has finally said that, okay, right to internet is a fundamental right. This is not an analysis, or this one-liner does not depict anyway what have you understood from that case and what do you think about the case. Your perception your understanding is very, very relevant, because that is how you will be able to contribute later on into the literature that is available for us, all of us, to read and revive our understandings. So I think I'll end up here, and we can take up questions.
Hi, Aranima. Okay, so thank you so much for this session. I'll just take the questions now. And again, it was a very informative session. The chat box was active the entire time. And, we got some really, really good questions. So I'll just start, from the last questions that we have got. So and go in reverse. So the last question is, what can you please explain ratio decedent die and orbital dicta? So if you could make it.
Yeah. When I say that right to internet is a fundamental right, and that was at the end given by the court. So this basically one liner remains to be a ratio at definitely, because when you read the case or when you would ever come to know of the case, this is one thing that you will be always able to identify that case with. So something that uniquely with that judgment, the court has tried to uniquely contribute in the sea of judgments that there are, becomes your issue. But there are certain observations that the court gives with regard to the issues that are at hand, which may not be relevant in deciding that case particularly. Maybe it will be talking about the fine line of difference between 19.1 and 19.2. Or what are the reasonable restrictions? It may talk about array of cases, and it may talk about how that balance needs to be created, how the states are hell-bent into including everything into 19.2 and strangulating people out of the freedom of expression. So all of these observations are in and around, revolving around that particular right. Right to internet is a fundamental right. But they're revolving around it. They're not specifically leading you to understand what is it that the court might have concluded by the end. So that remains to be your obiter dicta, whereas ratio is the major takeaway that you have and through which that case for the times to come will be identified as a contribution that the judge has made.
Thank you, Aranma. Okay, so I'll just first go through the Q&A box, and if anyone has any questions, please further write it there. So one question is, what is the difference between an SLP and an appeal?
So SLP is under 136, Article 136 is when you file it in the Supreme Court. An appeal could be at any level. From a trial court, it can travel through a high court. From a high court, it can further travel to a Supreme Court. So therefore, SLP is not understood to be an appeal here. Mm-hmm. Appeal would be a very general or generic term, which as a right, the parties are given if they're still aggrieved of what the court has adjudicated and how the courts have adjudicated their rights and liabilities. They may file the appeal in the next possible higher court that whichever has a jurisdiction there.
Okay. The next question, which, there have been few questions on this topic, which is that, if you could please revisit non-reportable judgments, like you explained, I think students were not able to comprehend as a whole. So what are non-reportable judgments? Can they use them? Do they have any value and so on?
See, one thing that we should, by logic, try to understand, if a judgment is not getting reported in several law reporters, the essence, value, and its finding somewhere is not that very relevant. Therefore, it becomes a non-reportable judgment at certain such cases. Now, when I was trying to discuss a very contemporary case that was presented in the Gujarat High Court, and the judge said that, okay, when we have, let's say, designated a judgment to be non-reportable, it does not go to the law reporters for them to use that judgment in the compilation, right? But then if I get a certified copy and I publish it on the internet, it does not become reportable. And again, it's not an offense that I'm doing, or maybe I'm doing a contempt of the court with regard to this. So they've just tried to demarcate something. Definitely, see, your book has some essential cases into it, right? Now, they are essential because they are landmark. They have certain ratios which you should, for conceptualizing your understanding, you must refer to and remember them. Therefore, the same logic I believe has been applied when the courts have designated judgments to be reportable and non-reportable. The reportable one is free for everybody to read. I mean, you can definitely download a non-reportable judgment. If you go to the Supreme Court website, it has three categories: all reportable, non-reportable. If you have the right case number or the category of case, whatever it is, there's a list of category. If you have every specific detail, you can download a non-reportable judgment. It's not that it does not go into the database. It does not get reported in the case law reporters.
Another thing on the same topic is that can someone use a non-reportable judgment as a citation somewhere? So I think they're referring to be it moots or be it, you know, in an internship.
So your non-reportable judgment will not have a citation. The very fact that citations are contained in that judgment, because it's been reported some in a number of law reporters, right? So the equivalent citation that we read in one of the slides that I made you look at, it had AIR, SCC, RCR. So these are law reporters. They generate a citation based on which you can search that case. Or you can probably search wherever that case has been cited in n number of judgments. So maybe it has a value of precedence for that matter. So therefore, a citation will only be contained in a reportable judgment. That is the idea of reporting the judgment that the court gives out.
Okay, so next question was that while summarizing a case, you know, when students are preparing a case analysis, be it for a project or an internship, do they always need to encompass all the arguments that have been taken by the plaintiff and the defendant counsels, you know, counsels for the both parties?
So this is when you're reading a case or when you are interning and you're part of witnessing a proceeding?
No, I think it's more about when you are making a case analysis, be it for a class project or you're doing a case analysis if you're, you know, in your internship someone has asked you.
Okay, so I'll make you go back, all of you will go back to that one case, one of the two cases that I made you look at in the, as part of the judgments in various clips of the slides. When the court has admitted the fact that right to internet is a fundamental right. Now, all those facts and contentions will be relevant, which is trying to vouch for that right. And from the other party side, which is trying to build up a case in the manner that, oh, we did not infringe that right at all. Or maybe contending to the fact that, okay, this is not even a right that's been identified by the court so far. So we cannot contest for that right at all. So when you've gone through the case once, you'll be able to understand in the second reading, never in the first reading, you'll be able to go through and understand what is that you should retain in terms of the contentions of the parties, or let's say the issues are not summarized in 1, 2, 3, 4 format, then how should you find them out? So therefore, what is important here is that you relate the judgment with the contentions that have been given and substantiated by relevant facts there. So if you're able to align that contention with the fact, those are the relevant contentions at the end that you can summarize and put it in your, let's say, paper or project that you're doing.
Okay, so just someone asked, and I think this is a very relevant question for first years, because almost all law schools have law of torts in their first year, okay? And law of torts has a lot of very old judgments. So, and mostly English cases, you know, we have a few, are bunch of Indian cases also, but they're mostly English cases. Someone has asked that for those cases, those old cases, do we need to read, you know, the actual bare act, you know, like the actual judgment text that is there, because there are no bare acts in this subject, there are no laws. So does reading those old judgments also help, and should a student read more than what has already been, you know, prescribed in the standard books like RK, you know, Bhangia, or all those books that are there?
I think reading a case I personally find more relevant is when it is of contemporary nature, or it is relating to some issue which is were prevalent in contemporary times, right? So when I told you that for what sort of cases should you go ahead and analyze, something that is contributing, something which is new, something which is maybe putting a question mark into the present system of law or a particular law provision, subclause, whatever that is. There is some confusion that is being created and that is being resolved by that case. Those are the cases which I think you should go at length and read about it. Whereas if you read cases at length, you will see Lord Diplock and several other English judges that are being cited by the Supreme Court and High Court judges. So definitely, I mean, you will get to understand a little bit gist of what they have said and why they've said so. But I would recommend that read the cases, which will familiarize you more with the contemporary issues.
Thank you. Again, you know, to add to that, there was another question someone wrote in the chatbot that, you know, I'm looking to write a paper and I don't know how to start. And this is a query that we get throughout any session that we conduct or any topic. Again, as you said, you know, when someone is reading a contemporary judgment, you will have those questions which would ultimately give you topics that you can write really good and, you know, relevant and publish worthy research on, something which hasn't been written before or which isn't so streamlined, which you found because you went through a judgment. So again, you know, that's another added advantage of it. I'm not we're short on time, but there were a lot of questions. So one is that how do you read a judgment quickly? And I completely understand, because I remember in my second year, the NCHAT judgment came and we had to do a moot and we had an issue which was related and it was a 2000 page judgment. So how do you expect someone to, you know, even finish that in an evening? It's such a huge judgment. So, you know, if like I wrote my pointers, what I felt should be done, but if you could guide someone that, okay, if you have such a voluminous judgment and you have to make sense of it, how do you read it?
See, you have now good 10 elements that we have figured out what are necessary for you to have a look at when you're reading a case. So when you start reading a case, you already have a guiding map towards it, right? That what are the essentials halls that you're going to make when you're going to read that judgment. Now, I understand a 2000 page judgment definitely needs a lot of good reading capacity that you have. I mean, you cannot begin with a 2000 page judgment, but you will, in the journey of reading various cases, would be able to read it quickly. Since you have that pointers and they are registered in your mind, there's a possibility that as and when you incur certain let's say paragraphs where contentions are given, where the arguments are given, you will be able to cull out. Now, this is through practice that you can do. I mean, I can probably guide you with the important ingredients that you must look at, but this is a matter of practice that will that you have to inculcate in yourself, because there is no escape. The reason why we are having this webinar is that we don't, if there's no escape for you to read cases through iBlock pleaders or XYZ platforms where they've shortened and written. They might have written the very correct thing, but I'll tell you, when you read a case, you are able to, you become a part of that case, a part of that journey. And like you see a movie, the same is an experience when you read a case. You are witnessing all of it and you will remember it for the times to come. Believe you me, if you read those four lines of ratio decidendi research and Google search from any of the websites, you will remember it until your end semesters. I can bet on that. But if you read that case, maybe there'll be some moot proposition where you'll suddenly be able to come up with n number of cases which have been discussed in XYZ case you completely read. So, I mean, we first thing as lawyers, as the lawyers in the making, we should be honest in terms of how diligent we are in terms of reading and understanding law. Only then is that the knowledge will come to us. Or a half-baked knowledge is not going to serve you in the professional world. That is what I can tell you at the least.
Okay, so someone just wrote that, okay, we have just come out of school and we were used to certain chapters and certain books and a certain kind of reading. Now when we are making that, and that's a very good question, now that we are making this transition to law school, where we have these books which are actually just the tip of the iceberg, you have your reference material that comes after, you have your reference books, judgments, and so on. So as a law student, how do we make that transition?
I think important habit that I would want all of you to inculcate is that reading newspapers. Half of the legal news are covered there itself. And then if it interests you, I don't think reading a little bit in detail is going to trouble you any further. It will only ease out your curiosity, and you have to be curious, my friends, because I think that is how you'll be able to imbibe the sea of knowledge that is there in front of you for all the 5 years of law school and life thereafter. So I think the most important part would here be that inculcate a habit of reading newspaper. The Hindu would be the best newspaper you can start off with. The language is a little tricky, but again, that will be for the better if you start reading it. And then you'll be able to get some idea about, okay, what is happening in the court? What is the court deciding on? What is the matter at this point in debate? Or what is a very burning contemporary point? Even the editorials are written based on many, many legal issues. And thereon, you will start making yourself more aware. See, law is everywhere. The technology that we are using, there's a law for it, or there will be a law for it, a more solidified law. There is a law for the entire pandemic turmoil that we saw. We are not vouching for more health laws or better health codes. So, I mean, if you look around, law is pervasive in every field that you are probably able to witness in and around. There's an environmental law, there's a technology law. Like Manupatra. So Manupatra, when it prepares the head notes or case notes, there is a copyright in it. So there are, I mean, it's around you, and you are in the best. I mean, you've inducted yourself in the best discipline of knowledge, where you will be aware about literally every dimension that there is in this world around. So that transition is, I think, a more, let's say, enlightening journey than a transition that you're going to be making. And I can bet on it that you'll be smarter than other friends of yours who've not taken up law.
Yeah, that is definitely there. We had the last session, which was about orientation to law school, and we discussed this, that it gives you the best base, even if you want to change streams later. Okay, so we are above time, but two questions that had come up that, someone had asked. So one is, and I got it in the last session also, which is, what are citations? You know, because students, and I completely understand that as first year law students, especially people who haven't done probably coaching for CLAT also, understanding what a citation is, you know, to okay. The very, very basic level.
I'll tell you a very layman understanding. You write your address at the end of your name, right? This is where you belong to. That is your citation. That is your citation, and therefore the case's citation is the address of the case. Simple.
Yeah, if someone has to find you, that is how they find you. If you have to find a case, that is how you find a case. Okay, so another was, can you explain the different type of benches that are there? So you were referring, you know, division bench, single judge bench and everything. That was one question.
So yes, there's a single judge bench, there's a division bench. Then the quorum expands to three judge bench, five judge bench, odd number of bench. I mean, judges have to be there because we need a judgment where there is a majority or unanimously agreed judgment that comes out of it. So 3, 5, 7, 9, 11, 13. Until 13, we've been able to come up with the set of judgments that we've seen in last odd 30, 35 years. So that is the, I think, the odd number chronology that we follow in terms of the benches that are there.
Okay. So again, thank you so much. Just one, because we are getting a lot of questions, I'll just, do one last question. So someone asked that as first year law students, and it's a very good way the curriculum is built in most law schools, that you don't have, most law schools don't have IPC or constitution in the first year. However, when you're studying legal English or other subjects, you get references to bare acts and judgments. So in that case, should a student be doing or reading, those judgments which are being referred, which are probably criminal law, constitution law, which they haven't been taught yet?
It is always recommended to stay ahead of time. So since you're not being introduced to major laws in your first and second semester, is because they understand you're making a transition. That is one of the major reasons. And then I've seen students asking back in my law school that, can we intern in corporate law firm? And my question to them is, do you even know what company law is? Not let alone any other code. So, but I've never discouraged them into saying that, okay, don't read it. Of course, I mean, the ocean of knowledge that is there in front of you, you have access to all the ebooks, probably your law school, which has facilitated through the digital sources. There's a library if you're joining offline. So you, based on your interest, can explore other laws or books or by way of cases which have not been taught to you. That is what I think. Although the law school curriculum with extracurricular activities, mooting, debating, and whatnot is in itself a lot of time-consuming and taxing thing that is there, at the onset of law school. But if you want to build your focus, let's say maybe you're interested in IPR, start reading a little bit about it. There is no harm. And apart from procedural laws, they are not very interrelated. So that if you don't read, let's say,
Arunima, we lost your voice. You're not audible.
Okay, then.
Yeah, now it's.
Yeah. So I was just trying to tell you all that probably being ahead of time and reading a little bit more than what is being recommended as part of your law school curriculum. You've seen, this entire pandemic time, people have done so many courses. If you're in first year, just ask your seniors from second and third and fourth year, what all Coursera courses they've done, what all webinars they've gone and attended, only to build in more knowledge. And probably that particular semester will offer you 2 to 3 courses of law. Maybe your interest somehow lies in tax laws, lies in IP laws, or lies in cyber laws or arbitration laws. I mean, this is something that when you start reading, you'll be able to explore. And the earlier you explore, I think you'll be in a better position. And when you reach your fourth or fifth year.
Thank you so much, Arunima, for this, really detailed section. And like the chat window, a lot of people can just write, if they want, they can write to the host and the panelists. I'm sure you're seeing the chat window. A lot of students are we were really confused about this, and thank you so much for guiding them. And to everyone present, thank you so much for joining this session. Again, this was the second part of the 4-part webinar series. The next two sessions we have on the 26th and the 29th. One is on MOOCs and research papers, and the other is on internships in law school. So if you found this session helpful, please be a part of those as well. As a takeaway, I have provided a judgment link in the chat window. If all of you could open that, you would see that this is the Vishakha judgment. We have analyzed the judgment for you. We have clearly demarcated, as Arunima discussed, what are the different elements of a judgment, as well as to all those who attended the previous session, all those judgment enhancement features that we had discussed on Manupatra that help you read a judgment. Both of those we have combined. We have
also, sorry to interrupt, I also have one or two cases, judgments that I took a soft copy of, but because we were slightly running out of time, I did not share it. You can share it with the participants later on. I'll share it with you.
Yeah. Okay, sure. Thank you so much. And yeah, we were having questions about that. So again, as I was saying, this one document, it is your roadmap on how do you read a judgment. Everything is clearly marked, demarcated. We have labeled it, so on and so forth. Furthermore, we have also given, the special enhancement features that were there that we had discussed the last time. So to everyone here, thank you so much for attending. Thank you so much, Arunima, for taking the time out and doing this session. Again, if anyone attends all 4 parts of these webinar series, especially as, related to today's session, we would be providing you a free law skills course on how you read judgments. So thank you so much, everyone, for your precious time, and hope to see you on the 26th.
All right. Thank you so much.